Mahalagang paalala, ang video na ito ay maaaring makawala ng pagod at lungkot na iyong nararamdaman, kaya ituloy lamang ang panonood at mag-relax.
Wondered about your human ancestors that lived more than 1 million years ago? You may have images of ape-like people that sheltered in caves and used clubs. A special group of scientists called paleoanthropologists used clues from the prehistoric record to uncover the mysteries of what early humans were really like. The work of these scientists helps us understand what it means to be human and how we evolved to the unique species that we are today. In this episode, we'll meet paleoanthropologist Brianna Pobiner to learn more about early human life by looking at what was on the menu 1 million years ago. Hi, thanks for joining us. I'm Maggie Benson, host of Smithsonian Science How. We have a really awesome show planned for you today. But before we get started, I want to ask you a question. You can respond using the poll that appears to the right of your video screen. What makes humans different from other animal species? Is it talking, walking upright, using tools, thinking abstractly, or having big brains? Take a moment to think about it and put your answer in the window that appears to the right of your video screen. It looks like the answers are still coming in, so before we go to the results, I want to introduce our special guest today. Today we have with us paleoanthropologist from Smithsonian's National Museum of Natural History, Dr. Brianna Pobiner. Thank you so much for being here with us today, Brianna.
You're welcome.
So right now, we basically have three answers coming in that are top. Walking upright, thinking abstractly, and using tools are all answers that people are responding that make humans unique. What do you think about that?
So I think in some ways all of those answers are correct, but really it's sort of an all of the above. It's the whole package that makes us uniquely human. We have these amazingly large brains. We have very sophisticated language and technology. And we walk upright on two legs, which is fairly unique among animals.
So I have to ask you, what about chimpanzees? I know that we're really similar to them in all of our behavior. So, I mean, does that make us really that unique?
We're not only similar to chimpanzees in our behavior, but the way that we look and also our genetics. So we are 98.8% genetically similar to chimpanzees. They do a lot of the things that we do. They walk upright from time to time. They use tools. They have fairly sophisticated communication. But actually, humans and chimpanzees share a common ancestor that lived about 6 or 7 million years ago. So we've had quite a long time to evolve on those separate paths. And if we have 3.2 billion base pairs in our genome, 1.2% difference is maybe 35 million differences.
Oh my God, so only 1.2% of our genetic code is different, but it really makes us uniquely human.
It does, that makes us who we are.
And I guess 6.7 million years of evolution too.
That's right, that's quite a long time.
So can you tell us what a paleoanthropologist is and what you do to study human evolution?
Sure, so a paleoanthropologist is essentially a scientist who's interested in early humans, what they did, how they lived, what they ate, all about their biology and behavior. And so fossils of the early humans themselves, we use animals' bones or fossils of animals that lived at the same time as those early humans. We can tell something about environments from those animals, possibly something about diet. We can also use the archaeological record, stone tools, pottery, any kind of basically anything that was left behind that early humans made.
Interesting. So it sounds like there are a lot of different puzzle pieces across those three lines of evidence.
There are, and it's really neat to try to fit those puzzle pieces together. We're never going to have every single piece, but really trying to kind of make sense of the evidence that we have.
So can you show us something? I see evidence on the table here. Can you show us something that you brought?
Sure. So I brought the exact replica of a skull of probably my favorite species on the human family tree, Homo erectus. And so one of the things that makes Homo erectus so special is that it started to incorporate a lot more meat into its diet. I'm really interested in meat eating in early human diets. And so by about 1.8, 1.9 million years ago, when this species evolved, it started to eat more meat and more marrow and other things from large animals. We can see that reflected in the shape of its skull. So in comparison to a species like Australopithecus afarensis, which lived much earlier back to almost 3.9 million years ago, the slope of the face is much different. A lot of the face of Australopithecus afarensis was really used for chewing. But then once early humans started using stone tools to butcher meat, they could basically process food outside of their mouths. And so our teeth got smaller, but our brains got bigger.
Interesting. So what did we eat before we started eating meat? So what did maybe afarensis eat?
So back, even back to the earliest human ancestors, back to 6 or 7 million years ago, we probably had a very omnivorous diet, so eating plants and animals, eating things like fruit and leaves and berries, and probably small animals, maybe insects, lizards, eggs, all sorts of things, kind of anything we could get our hands on.
So you mentioned that there were other species other than afarensis and Homo erectus. How many human species were there?
So the family tree, our family tree is pretty bushy, actually. It's very diverse. So there were maybe somewhere between 18 and 20 species on our family tree. And at any one time, there were often several species living at the same time. So it's fairly unique to be a modern human and to be the only species kind of left standing. You can see right there kind of on the top of the tree.
And did all of these animals live at the same time?
So many of them did. You can see where some of them overlap. And in fact, modern humans, our time span overlaps with at least three different other early human species.
Interesting. So where the early humans that you study, where did they live?
So there are a couple places that I work. One site that I am currently doing research at is called Alorga Sile. It's a site in southern Kenya, in the southern Kenya Rift Valley. And we actually have a beautiful photo of Alorga Sile right in back of us. This is what the landscape looks like. It's very eroded, but I think it's quite beautiful. And we're working at Alorga Sile under the direction of Dr. Rick Potts, who's also a paleoanthropologist here at the Natural History Museum.
And what kind of things do you look at Alorga Sile?
So I'm particularly interested in looking at the animal bones there. And I've actually brought one with me today. So I'm interested, this is a rib of some sort of large animal, maybe about a zebra size, that's about a million years old.
Wow, that's so interesting. So you may find some of these fossil bones here at your field site in Alorga Sile. What else do you find at the field site here?
So we find lots of different types of evidence, and it really takes a team to be able to put together the pieces of this prehistoric puzzle. So we have archaeologists who study the stone tools. We have the paleoanthropologists or physical anthropologists who study the actual fossils of early humans. We have paleontologists that study the animal bone fossils. But geologists are also key. So these are scientists that help us figure out how old the fossils and artifacts were, and also help us reconstruct the types of landscapes and environments that early humans lived in.
Wow, that's really interesting. So we already have a student question for you. Are you ready to take it?
Sure.
All right. And this one comes from Amy from Acacia, and she wants to know, who is our closest relative?
Who's our closest relative? That's a good question. That's sort of a $1 million question. So right now, based on available evidence, we think that our direct ancestor is a species called Homo heidelbergensis. This species lived in Africa and in Asia, and in Europe, that dating back to about 800,000 years ago. So populations of this species in Africa evolved eventually into our species, modern humans or Homo sapiens, about 200,000 years ago. And the populations in Europe evolved into Neanderthals. And Neanderthals are our closest extinct relatives.
Wow, interesting. So we have another question for you. And this one comes from Ruth. Ruth wants to know, is there any way to know what we will evolve into?
Wow, that's a fascinating question. A lot of that's hard to predict. So the way that evolution works is that changes often happen or are selected for in response to a particular selective pressure, in response to a particular environment or challenge. So not knowing what those challenges will be in the future, it's a little hard to predict how our evolutionary trajectory is going to proceed.
Great. So I want to get back to this bone that you brought here that was recovered from a Lorgasili 1 million years ago. You said that looking at marks on bones is your primary research. What do you look at when you look at marks?
I'm particularly interested in trying to figure out who made these marks on bones. So some of these marks were made by early humans when they used sharp stone tools to butcher animals. Some of these marks were made by carnivores when they were basically eating their prey and munching on these bones.
So like we see on the screen here, are those chew marks or what?
So those are great examples of cut marks on fossil bones. Cut marks are linear, they're very narrow, they usually have a V shape at the bottom, and they're usually either oriented right across the bone or kind of diagonally across the bone. In contrast, carnivore tooth marks, especially tooth pits, they're usually round, they're crushed on the bottom of the surface of the mark, and they're kind of can sometimes be scattered throughout the bone or often sometimes kind of concentrated on places where carnivores have chewed.
So I want to know how you actually do the research to be able to understand what made that mark on the bone, because we don't have a looking glass to look back a million years ago.
I would love that. So one thing I do is I'm trying to determine what different carnivore chewing patterns look like. And so to do that research, I work at another site in Kenya called Olpejeta Conservancy, which is a site in central Kenya. It's a modern game reserve. I'm working there together with my colleague, Dr. Fire Kavarovic from Durham University in the UK. And we are basically looking at kills that lions, leopards, hyenas, different carnivores have made to try to determine if we can figure out what that lion chewing pattern, that leopard chewing pattern looks like. So we go out in these modern landscapes, we follow these carnivores around, and then we pick up their leftovers and study those bones.
Is that scary? I mean, you're out on this modern game reserve with these big carnivores.
Not only with these big carnivores, these big meat eaters, but elephants and rhinos and buffalo. It can be a little scary, but we always go out with an armed guard, with an armed ranger, anytime we're out of the car to make sure that we're safe.
Interesting. So did you bring any objects here today that show what some of these chew marks look like on the bones?
I did. And so here is one example of a zebra bone that has some nice chewing damage from a lion. So you can see right here where the arrow is, there's kind of a basically a big carnivore tooth mark back here. And over here is all of this kind of nibbling damage that happened when a lion was chewing to try to get this meat off and ended up chewing part of the bone.
So you've done a great job helping us understand what a chew mark looks like and a bite mark and a cut mark. So let's go back to this rib bone that you brought.
Sure. So
So I think maybe we should ask the students what they think that these marks were made from.
That sounds great.
Wonderful. So students, take a look at this bone and maybe Brianna will point out what marks we're looking at. And what do you think the marks on the bone were from? Grass impressions, tooth marks, water staining, or butchery marks? Brianna, the answers are coming in, and 50% of our students think that they're butchery marks. What do you think about that?
I think that's a great answer. And so really, it's the fact that they're quite linear and straight and narrow that gives away that those are butchery marks.
So they're butchery marks made by stone tools. That means that early humans were using stone tools a million years ago?
Actually, early humans were using stone tools all the way back to about 2.6 million years ago. We have very sort of simple technology at that point. So we basically have simple rocks with flakes that were knocked off of those rocks. Not very sophisticated, but they were really perfect at getting a sharp edge to be able to slice meat off of bone. But by the time Homo erectus came around, there was a big innovation in stone tool technology. So this is a hand axe. This is a real hand axe from Alorga Siley. And this hand axe has a very specific pattern that the sharp flakes were taken off around the edge. And it's actually a very efficient way to use your stone tool raw material.
Great. So we have another student question. This one comes from Long Gone Daddy. Is there any evidence that particular diet and nutrients contributed to brain or language development?
Ooh, that's a good question. And actually, there is a lot of evidence, or at least a good hypothesis, that eating meat contributed to an increase in brain size. And so meat is a great resource. It has a lot of calories, it has a lot of fat and nutrition, and being able to get all of that in kind of a smaller package versus a lot of leaves or fruit may have enabled our brains to grow bigger.
Great. So this one comes from Brianna from FIS, and she wants to know, where do you take the fossils after you piece them together?
Oh, that's a good question. So all of the fossils stay in the country where they've excavated from, where they've been excavated. So all of the fossils from Alorga Siley stay at the National Museums of Kenya. They go to the Central Museum in Nairobi.
Great. So you mentioned that these stone tools were used for butchery. Does that mean that they were actually hunting with them too, or were they just using them to butcher the animals and eat the meat after some animal may have gotten to it?
That is another million-dollar question. So we don't have evidence for hunting technology in the archaeological record until about 500,000 years ago. You'll notice that's 2 million years after the evidence for this meat eating started. So we think that sometimes actually early humans were coming in after carnivores were done with their kills or maybe even chasing them off, and that's how they were getting meat from these big animals.
So were the early humans kind of waiting in the bushes, waiting for these lions to get off their prey?
It's hard to know. We don't have evidence for some of that specific behavior. But we can infer from where cut marks are on bones, if the early humans are getting the really juicy parts of carcasses, it's an indication that they may have been chasing carnivores off of kills or somehow being able to get better access to the best parts of the animals.
So is that primitive, the scavenging, or is it actually an advance for that time period to be able to be waiting and then butchering these animals?
You know, it's funny, I think scavenging gets a really bad rap, but I think it's actually a fairly sophisticated behavior. So you really have to know your environment very well, know where the carnivores tend to hunt, have advanced planning and very sophisticated communication and group dynamics and social interaction. So I think it's actually a pretty advanced kind of behavior.
So interesting. I mean, eating meat really was the critical changing point for us to be able to have all of these human unique qualities.
I think that's at least it was a very big changing point. And so there's two other kind of big shifts in early human diet. One is by about 800,000 years ago, we have good evidence that humans were using fire for cooking. And then by about 15,000 years ago, it's kind of late in the record as far as we're concerned, but we have good evidence for agriculture and domestication, which is basically growing plants and tending animals for our own food resources.
Wonderful. You've done a really great job at explaining to us what a paleoanthropologist does, about your field work here in Kenya and the evolution of really our human diet. Let's go to some student questions.
Sounds good.
All right. This one comes from Louisa. Louisa wants to know, my early humans have gotten the idea of cooking meat from scavenging meat from animal caught in wildfires.
That's a really good question. And so we think there were probably occasional wildfires that lightning strikes or something ended up lighting these wildfires. So it certainly could have been from something like that. That's a good idea.
This question comes from Hagen, and Hagen wants to know, why were animals from millions of years ago so much bigger than they are today?
That's actually a really good question. And so we have really across the whole world in almost all of our continents, there are big extinct animals that are no longer around today. And I think it's complicated, but there's probably a lot of reasons for that.
So this one comes from Harold Woods. And Harold Woods wants to know, how many different types of food did we eat before we started eating meat?
That's a very good question. And so we have a lot of types of food we were probably eating that don't preserve things like fruit and leaves and berries. So we can get preserved bones and sometimes even preserved little bits of plants, but it's harder to look really deep back in the record and figure out what we were eating.
So this one comes from Scott in Fairfax. And Scott in Fairfax wants to know, did early humans eat raw meat?
No. I think the answer is yes. And so we have meat eating back to about 2.6 million years ago at least. But we don't have good evidence for cooking until 800,000 years ago. It's possible that we'll find earlier evidence for cooking, but it looks like raw meat was being eaten for a long time.
So Otto from Rapid City wants to know, what education do you need to do this kind of work?
So the first thing you need is a college degree, usually in anthropology, but maybe in biology or geology, or even something like chemistry and physics to do some of those dating techniques. And then most people do go on and get a master's and a PhD.
So, Brianna, what made you interested in paleoanthropology?
So I admit that I was not as interested in science when I was in high school than I am now. But it was really a class that I took in college with a really inspiring professor that got me started on the anthropology path. And then I went to a field school in South Africa and absolutely fell in love with the discovery and thinking about human prehistory and trying to find those pieces to that puzzle.
Great. We have another question, and this one comes from Jacqueline. And she wants to know, do you ever find painting on any of the bones that you find? Hmm.
So interestingly, we do. Sometimes we can find coloring, so pigments, either red pigments made of ochre or black pigments like manganese. Occasionally, we do find staining on those bones.
Wow, and you think that that is then two lines of evidence together as one, both a human artifact and a fossil bone?
Exactly, and so it's a little bit later in time, so we really don't have the evidence for making art until a couple hundred thousand years ago, but we certainly do find, you know, kind of marks on stones and bones and certainly caves and things like that.
Great. So Alex has a question, and Alex wants to know, did our bones get bigger over time?
So our brains got bigger over time, and that meant that our skulls had to get bones. Our whole skeletons got gradually bigger over time.
And that was really because of meat eating.
It probably played a big part, yeah.
That's so interesting. I mean, I'm looking here at the models that you have out on the table. What order did they come in? Do you know?
Yeah, so probably actually I would have to switch these two. And so the earlier fossils from Australopithecus afarensis leading into the earliest members of our genus, the genus Homo. So you can see a little bit of change in the size of the brain and the slope of the face. And then once we get past Homo erectus to Neanderthals, you can see they're much bigger and actually have a really large brain and very big brow ridges.
Now, Neanderthals, in the geologic record, they're kind of recent, aren't they?
They are, and actually they evolved around the same time that modern humans did, about 200,000 years ago.
And they were found in North America?
They were found in Europe and in Western Asia.
Oh, okay.
And actually, modern humans, when they migrated into Europe, encountered Neanderthals. They were living in the same place at the same time. And we actually know from genetics that they occasionally interbred, that they mated with each other.
Great. So we have another question from Patrick. And Patrick wants to know, how did early man learn to make tools?
Oh, that's a great question. I'm not sure we'll ever answer that question. And so it may have been initially just picking up sharp stones and using those as stone knives that gave people the idea to actually make early stone tools and to manufacture them instead of to just kind of go out and collect them. But we really don't know. It's a good question.
Wonderful. Okay, this one comes from David. And David wants to know, when did the early humans learn to build shelters?
Oh, so that's a good question. We have the earliest evidence for building shelters back to about 400,000 years ago. At least that's what we can discern in the prehistoric record.
John B., what is your favorite fossil that you found?
Wow, that's a hard question, because I'm very, you know, I love all the fossils that I found, but probably some of the fossils that I found where I'm digging up in layers that are about 1.5 million years old, and I can pick up bones like this cut marked bone, and I know that the last person that touched this lived 1.5 million years ago, wasn't quite like me, but it's really like reaching through the past and
sounds exhilarating.
It's amazing.
So Brian wants to know, since the tools were made of stone, how hard were they to use?
Oh, that's a good question. They actually weren't that hard to use in the sense that you could pick one up, one that had a sharp edge, and it's not hard to actually slice meat off of those bones. Tools were also used for pounding, for probably processing plants, and so it was probably hard to make them, but not as hard to use them.
This one comes from Jonathan, and he says, besides the brain, did any other organs change?
Well, interestingly, about the same time that we see the brain size increasing, we actually see the size of our guts and our whole digestive tract decreasing. Those things might be related. So our brains take up about 2% of our body weight, but they take up 20% of our energy, and our guts take up a lot of energy. So potentially with eating meat, we can actually, we didn't need guts as big, so they got smaller and brains got bigger.
Interesting. So in a kind of related question, Elma wants to know, did salmonella or any other kind of diseases exist back then that we have today?
It's interesting. So there are evidence, it's rare, but we do have evidence of diseases. There's actually cancer or bone lesions on a Neanderthal rib from tens of thousands of years ago. And there is actually a partial skeleton from northern Kenya where we know that this woman suffered from hypervitaminosis A, probably actually eating something that had a really high concentration of vitamin A, which is especially concentrated in liver and actually carnivore liver.
Wow, so you can really actually see some of those diets in the fossil record
and
too.
And diseases sometimes, exactly.
So this one comes from Lindsay, and Lindsay wants to know, how do you feel about indigenous creation stories?
I think that basically how we became human is a part of what it means to be human, but I think that the stories that we have in a cultural context of how we became human are also a really important part of who we are.
Great. So this one is kind of funny. Sophia wants to know, will our pinky toe evolve away?
You know, it's funny. So actually having five fingers and toes is a really primitive condition in a sense, is that that goes back really far in our evolutionary history. Unless there was really strong selection for some reason for our pinky toes to go away, they're probably going to stay put.
That's a good question.
It is a good question.
So Raymond wants to know, is there any difference in early human bones becoming fossils as opposed to animal bones?
The process was probably the same. And a lot of the bones, if you find human and animal bones in the same layers, they usually look the same. It's really just the size and shape of the bone that lets us know what kind of animal or human they came from.
Going back to the size and the shape of the bone, Anthony G, he wants to know, how do you tell what kind of bone it is? Is there a spot on the bone that tells you what kind of bone it is?
So that's a good question. I actually spend a lot of my time trying to figure out what bones these fossils are. So sometimes on parts of the bones, there are very specific shapes, like you can see some of these curves and ridges here. So if you get chunks of bone that have these shapes, they're a lot easier to diagnose. But sometimes when you have really little pieces, it's really hard to tell.
So you're really kind of like a forensic anthropologist too.
What they are.
Thank you so much for being here today and teaching us about paleoanthropology, human evolution, and early human diets. It's been really enlightening.
Oh, well, thanks a lot.
So is there anywhere that students can go to learn more about human evolution and the work you do?
So I would suggest going to our website, which is humanorigins.si.edu. If you're on social media, you can follow us on Twitter at Human Origins, and then you can also find us on Facebook, Smithsonian Human Origins Program.
Thank you so much.
Thanks.
So thanks again for joining us today. We're glad that you came. If you missed part of this broadcast or want to watch it again, it'll be archived at curious.si.edu later tonight. Thanks for joining us, and see you next time on Smithsonian Science How.
In your visual landscape with animals, you see them for months, years, and plants. So you have a familiarity factor. But mushrooms that come up and disappear in 4 or 5 days, some of them can feed you, some can kill you, some can heal you, some can send you on a spiritual journey. So to have something so powerful and yet so ephemeral, it's natural for humans to avoid that which they don't understand out of fear because they don't know the difference. But, you know, 23 primates consume mushrooms, humans being one of them. And so that speaks to a long ancestral use of mushrooms going back, you know, in our primate evolutionary tree for a very, very long time. We separated from fungi 650 million years ago.
Maybe you did, dude. I know some people that are probably still.
Well, basically, we are descendants of fungi.
Yeah.
We share more common ancestry with fungi than we do with any other kingdom.
And fungi are closer to animals than they are to plants.
Animals came from fungi. Whoa. You and I are actually fungal bodies. Oof. I'm speaking to basically another fungal body right now.
Okay.
And from a cellular point of view, under the microscope, human cells, animal cells, and fungal cells are very, very similar. We exhale carbon dioxide, we inhale oxygen. And it's really interesting that the many of the bacterial diseases that infect fungi also infect us. Our best antibiotics against bacteria come from fungi, penicillin being the obvious example. But, you know, the universe was created about 13.8 billion years ago from the Big Bang. The Earth coalesced out of stardust about 4.5 billion. The earliest records of life we have is about 3.8 ago, single-celled organisms, but just recently in lava beds in South Africa, they found mycelium infused through the lava 2.4 billion years ago. Now, we split from fungi 650 million years ago. And then in Brazil this past year, they found a fully intact, apparently a fossilized mushroom published in Nature, which is a very reputable scientific journal. And that one is 1.4 billion years old. So the oldest multicellular organism in the fossil record today is this fungus and lava in South Africa 2.4 billion years ago. A fully formed mushroom who had its form was growing 1.4 billion years ago. We separated from fungi 650 million years ago. Mushrooms have had their form longer than we've had our form by more than a billion years. So, but think of that. Mushrooms had their form before we had ours.
Yeah.
These are elders. These are ancient organisms. These are the overlord underlords of our ecosystem. And I suspect, and as these neural networks, they have more neural connections in the mycelial mass, they're over 1,000 acres than we have in our brain. They are actually accumulating not only genetic intelligence, but I think that as time goes on, I hope that we will be able to interface with them, because I think that there is many benefits of us communicating with mycelium that can give us rapid responses to catastrophia. That's how they've evolved. And we're now the biggest walking catastrophe that I know, walking across the planet. And we need to engage these fungal allies for the benefits that we need to put into play in order to prevent the loss of biodiversity.
It seems like a communication gap would be very hard to bridge. The communication gap, I mean, if we really did find a way to communicate in some form with mushrooms, like the concept of language, like you were talking about, just the idea of nature and intelligence and these words that we have these concrete definitions in our head that don't really apply to some things that are very, very confusing to us, like the idea of fungal intelligence, the idea that you could somehow or another understand the language that these things, we don't even understand dolphin language, right?
Well, one classic example, Japanese are so clever at this. There's a slime mold, called Physarium polycephalum. And they had and this slime mold is very, very good at navigating through mazes and challenges. I mean, first to food wins, the conservation of energy, is rewarded. So
how do they set this up? Put a little bit of it.
they did several experiments. The most fun one is they designed a nutrient, basically a nutrient-like maze, replicating Tokyo in the Japanese subway system. And so they started it with Tokyo, and they put oats, which is a nutritional source. They inoculated what is on this basically an agar map, with all the major cities, the nodes around Tokyo. And they then make each of those nodes had a piece of oat on them, which was a source of nutrition. The main oat was where Tokyo was. They inoculated it, and then they let the slime mold then grow. And first it grew out randomly, exploratorily, just like you would do if you're a hunter or something, you're hunting on the landscape looking for things. And then after about 28 hours, it reorganized itself in the most efficient way possible and reorganize the Japanese subway system in a more efficient manner than it's designed today. Thus, they said, not me, not Paul Stamets, this is a demonstration of cellular intelligence.
Whoa.
So this is the tip of the proverbial mycelial iceberg, you know. This is has broad implications. And I just want people to suspend their disbelief. And this goes into actually the evolution of human consciousness. And Terrence McKenna was a good friend of mine. I love Terrence. I especially loved him the last 5 years of his life because he made fun of himself so much. Terrence and Dennis both came up with a stoned ape theory. Now, it's not a theory, it's a hypothesis. A hypothesis is speculative, but cannot necessarily be, as not yet proven. A theory is a hypothesis that has been tested and proven with facts. So I disagree with them in saying it's not a theory, it's a hypothesis. But the hypothesis of the stoned ape, which I think you've alluded to before, is that with climate change and as the savannas increase and our primate ancestors came out of the forest canopies, they're tracking across the savanna. And if you're a hunter, what do you look? You look for footsteps and you look for a scat. And the most significant fleshy mushroom going out of poop in Africa, hippopotamus, elephant, you know, deer, antelope, etc., is Slothsby cubensis. It's a very large mushroom. You're hungry. You're with your clan. You consume it. And then 20 minutes later, you are catapulted in this extraordinary experience. Psilocybin substitutes as serotonin, becomes a better neurotransmitter, activates neurogenesis. It causes new neurons to form. That the human brain, basically the brain cavity doubled in size in about 2 million years. Some people say as less as less than 200,000. Homo sapiens
less than 200,000 years?
Yeah. Homo sapiens arrived 200,000 to 300,000 years ago.
That's a big gap, right?
It's a big gap. Well, the science is like that. So you want, you know, to be scientifically accurate here, I need to show the extreme margins of what's been estimated. So if we accept 2 million years that and it's been shown in the fossil record, this is true, the oldest Homo sapiens fossils are 300,000 years old now. But we have a suddenly doubling of the human brain. And with that, our language centers increased, our ability to prognosticate, to plan. And there's no explanation for this currently. And even though we may not be able to prove it, I ask people to suspend their disbelief for a second. Now think of this. Our primate ancestors are going across the savanna. They ingest these mushrooms as a clan. Massive input for anyone who's eaten these mushrooms. Huge amounts of data is coming in. Fractal patterns, geometrical, you know, landscapes occur. You have empathy. You have greater courage. You're fighting a saber-toothed tiger. You know, one day you have a fear of it. We know now from neurogenesis and the extinction of the fear response that has been clinically proven, psilocybin allows you to reset and have different neurological pathways to respond to fear, overcoming the fear of conditioned response, potentially PTSD, and there's a lot of research on this currently. So, but this wouldn't happen one time with one hominid group. Wouldn't happen two times, 10 times. It happened millions and millions and millions and millions of times over millions and millions of years. This leads to what I think is called, this should be called epigenetic neurogenesis. We know that there's a regeneration of neurons. We know that psilocybin substitutes as serotonin. It opens the floodgates of the senses. You have a lot more data coming in. And we know that you have the extinction of the fear response. So if you're the leader of your clan, you've had this traumatic event, either war or cataclysm from earthquakes, whatever the case may be, or encounter a saber-toothed tiger, whatever. If you're the leader of that clan and you can overcome your fear response, you have courage and you have empathy. Those are leadership skills. I think people should take note of it. People like to follow leaders who are courageous and yet kind, who they can trust. They'll have their best interests in mind. So I think this propelled, I think it's a lot, it's a very good explanation. It's an unprovable hypothesis. But now we're at a junction and we're ready for the next quantum leap in human consciousness.
For more interesting videos like this one, please subscribe. Oh.